118, beginning in verse 1. Psalm 118, beginning in verse 1. Blesses the Lord to hear those turning pages. Verse 1. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, His steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, His steadfast love endures forever. Let those, all of us who fear the Lord, say, His steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Out of the distress of my heart, I called on the Lord, and the Lord answered me, and He set me free. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me, and they surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees, and they went out like a fire among thorns. And in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord, He helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Glad songs of salvation are in the tents of the righteous. For the right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord exalts. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live, and I shall recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has disciplined me severely, but He has not given me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. For this is the gate of the Lord, the righteous shall enter through it. I thank You that You have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and He has made His light to shine upon us. So bind the festal sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, that is our declaration this morning. Lord, we want to soak up, Lord Jesus, all of Your love, all that You have for us this morning. This is the reason we are here. Lord, we are here to receive, Lord Jesus, and we're here to respond as we were created to respond, to worship You, to thank You, for You are good and for Your steadfast love. It does endure. It endures to generation after generation after generation. So, Lord, would You open our eyes, open our hearts, open our ears, Lord, in order that we might not miss out all that the Spirit has to say this morning through Your word, because we know, Lord Jesus, Your word is truth. In the midst of a world of deception, lies, falsehoods, betrayals, assumptions, Lord, pedestals, Lord Jesus, we look upon Your truth this morning as the only way that we can possibly live in righteousness and in holiness. And in this we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. It is a privilege for me to be able to preach this morning. I was able to preach a couple months ago, and I preached from the Psalms. I preached from Psalm 65, and you know, I like preaching from the Psalms. I like preaching from the Psalms because usually they're complete as individual works, you know. They have a beginning, they have a middle, they have an end, and they have just this way of being able to provide completeness for us, to give us answers to the questions that we have, to give us the words that we just don't necessarily know how to speak in prayer and worship to the Lord. And it really is because the Psalms all hold a common key. They hold a common purpose. And it's because of this. It's because that the Psalms are songs. They're really written from the perspective of many writers, from the perspective of just the full emotion of the human heart, the full emotion of the human heart spent out in worship and communication to God. And so as believers, you know, there are definitely always a necessity to have access and to respond to Christ in the words of the Psalms. Because I don't know, you know, if you've been a Christian for 5 minutes, you might have discovered that the Christian life, it's not a guaranteed life of ease and comfort, is it not? Can I get an amen? It's not a life of guaranteed ease, success, wealth, sustenance. But oftentimes, you know, we are living and we suffer through a world that not only rejects the God that we love and we serve, but just as Christ says in the Gospels, rejects us also. And it's interesting because of that, we need to know how to ask the right questions and respond in the right ways, specifically when we are walking in hardship and in trials. Because this is what we can misassume as Christians. We can misassume that the joy, the peace, the stability that Christ promises, it doesn't come from Him bringing us happiness, okay? His joy, His peace, His stability doesn't necessarily come from when He brings us happiness, but they do come when He brings us holiness. And in bringing us holiness, friends, that's a happy life. That's a happy life. This is why we discover often, And it's personal for me, and I'm sure it's personal for you as you live out your day-to-day lives. You discover what really defines Christ-like joy, what really defines Christ-like peace, what really defines Christ-like stability, are these things that are often discovered in not the ease of life, but the hardship of life, right? In the difficulty, in our dialogue and communication with God when we're asking these deep questions and we get the response from Him in His Word, we discover really who Christ is. What throne does He sit on in my life when we go through hardship and trial? And this is why we find when you peruse, when you look through the Psalms, this is why we find different varieties of Psalms within the book as a whole. Many scholars, they try to categorize, well, this number falls in this category, this psalm falls in this category. Throughout the centuries, they sought to categorize them. We see songs of repentance. When there's those times when we know that we've sinned before the Lord and we approach Him in humility and in confession and we desire to say, Lord, I repent, but I just don't know how the words to say it. We look upon the psalms of repentance to speak for us. There's songs of sorrow and lament when we've gone through hard issues in our life that are difficult and often tempt us to wander. We come to the songs of lamentation and of sorrow and say, yes, this psalmist knows exactly what I have gone through, and he knows the words to be able to say to the Lord, Lord, be our refuge, be our strength, do not forsake us. And here we have songs of thankfulness, which is the category which we're going to find our text this morning. And I think, you know, it's pretty appropriate for us, especially as we walk into this month, or halfway through, this month of thankfulness to God. I don't know about you, it was a priority in my family to focus in the month of November just how thankful we are to the Lord's provision and grace and mercy to us in the former year. I don't know about you, but I think it's interesting that Thanksgiving is really near the end of the year for us to kind of recollect, to kind of have some personal evaluation. And I'm sure we run the gamut, we run the diversity of sitting under a God who knows that, wow, this year was just a year of blessing. 2016, a year of blessing and grace and mercy, and it all comes to, all originates from Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And we're thankful because it doesn't come from us. All of the success and happiness comes from him because he's taught us to thank him. Or you could be thinking about 2016 and just waiting. I mean, is it over yet? I'm ready for it to be over. I don't know about you. Where you're saying, this year has just been a season of wandering, a season of every step that I have taken has been a stumble. Every obstacle that I have met, I have failed at. Lord Jesus, I'm just ready for something new. I'm ready for a new refreshment of your promise, a new refreshment of your goodness as I enter into this coming year. Well, it is appropriate for us to look at specifically this psalm of thanksgiving, no matter where we stand concerning 2016. Now, before we start again, we need to bring the assumption again that when we are thanking God, it's due to either a current season of goodness or wealth or success. We should thank him for that. But then we should also thank him during those seasons of hardship and trial. And the grand question, even that statement, you can be asking in your heart, well, why? I mean, why is it appropriate for me to thank the Lord in the midst of hardship? Why is it necessary for the Lord to bid me come and worship him in the midst of an acting and hard trial? And this is what we're going to unfold. There's something about praying and praising the Lord with the Psalms, especially in midst of trial. I don't know, you know, for me, there are times when faced with the season of hardship throughout the years or in ministry, on the mission field with our family, when I would read the Psalms and it would speak as if the Lord was speaking directly to my situation. And what happens is, you know, it's not as if that psalm kind of stands out. What happens is that psalm almost becomes possessive of you. It's yours. You're like, out of all the other psalms, those are wonderful. But in this time and in this place, this psalm is mine because it's my refuge. Because it points to a particular aspect of the Lord that I must find my anchor in, because if not, I'm going to be tossed to and fro, a part of the waves. It becomes my psalm. For me specifically, especially in the Psalms, and I'm going through a difficulty, I'll put down the date. I'll write down the date upon the chapter. And so when I'm scrolling through it in the later years, and I can look at that date and I say, oh, I remember how hard that was. And the Lord has always been faithful. He's continued to be faithful. Martin Luther, you know, he said this same thing about the Psalms, and he even said specifically about Psalm 118. This is what he said. He says, this is my own psalm. This is my beloved psalm. He says, when emperors and kings, when the wise and the learned and even saints could not aid me, this psalm proved a friend and helped me out of many great troubles. As a result, it is dearer to me than all the wealth, honor, and power of the Pope, the Turk, and the Emperor, and I would be most unwilling to trade this psalm for all of it. That's a man who understands the value of the Word of God. The man who understands the value behind us praying to the Lord, asking for a response, desiring to hear his voice, then opening up Scripture and seeing that answer. And so this is the paradox we're going to be looking at this morning. Why is it necessary to thank the Lord? Why is it necessary to worship the Lord, especially in trials of hardship? So let's just dive right in. Verses 1 through 4 together. Beginning in verse 1, oh, grand exclamation, right? Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. All right, Bible studiers, what do you think this topic is concerning verses 1 through 4? His steadfast love! A plus. It's all about his steadfast love. And just to kind of take a step back, we need to see the origin. We need to see the foundation of where that steadfast love comes from. Notice verse 1. What does the psalmist proclaim? First and foremost, there is a reason to thank God. Why? Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Two grand statements, two grand truths that should shatter our misassumption about being completely alone in trials and in hardships. Two grand truths for us to see in verse 1. Number one, there's a God in heaven who exists. He is alive, he is breathing, and number two, he is good. He exists and he is good. All of his inherent qualities, all that he performs upon us through this world is because of his goodness. You can take this all the way back to the beginning of time when creation was born out of the lips of the living God. We remember, what does it say? When creation was born, after every day, it told us that the Lord saw it and it was good. It was good. Why was it good? It was only good because it came from good, and the came from good because it came from the good God himself. So, this should bring a grand understanding wherever we stand to know that there is no circumstance on heaven or on earth that will separate me from the truth that God is alive, he exists, and that he is good. So why is he good? Why is there reason to thank him? It's because of his steadfast love. His steadfast love is not just a flippant, temporary love. It is a love that endures. It is loyal. It is honorable. And it is forever. You know, some translations say, for the Lord is good, for his mercy endures forever. That's interesting, and we'll get into unfolding of why it's a little bit different with steadfast love, but our focus is a very important one here. Important enough to make this really, from the psalmist, he found that this statement, that the Lord is good, that his steadfast love endures forever, is so important that it bookends this psalm. Did you notice that? It begins with his enduring steadfast love, and it will end with his enduring and steadfast love. God's love is steadfast. What does that mean? It means that his love endures and has endured past, present, and future. Okay? We have a hard time grasping infinity future. We have an even harder time grasping infinity past. Where was God before the beginning of time and of creation? As Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, what were they doing? In the darkness, standing alone together in the midst of holiness and righteousness. Isn't that something interesting to ponder about? If we understand that God's love endures past, present, and future, if we get a good grasp of that, what we will come to the conclusion of is that we will understand that no matter what happens, God's love does not wax or wane based on anything that I do. I mean, that's kind of a hard truth for us to understand, right? Because any other love is a love that is somewhat temporal. Any other love is ultimately faulty because it comes from a sinner's perspective. But when we understand that God's love is wholly different, that it does endure, that it does last, and it will last forever and ever, we can have a truth and an anchor to hold on to that say, no matter what I am standing in, his love does not wax and it does not wane. It remains steadfast. It remains loyal. So, let's look at that real quickly. What does steadfast love mean in the past? What does steadfast love mean concerning God in the present? What does his steadfast love mean concerning the future? Well, let's go back again, even before the beginning of time. Before time began, God dwelt in an everlasting love relationship with the Trinity. Friends, this is why the doctrine of the Trinity is such an important doctrine, foundational for our Christian faith. Because without it, we cannot properly understand God's love. Before time began, there was alone Father, Son, and Holy Spirit sharing in a wondrous, harmonious relationship of steadfast love. Meaning before you and I were created, there was a God in perfect righteousness with Himself. Which means it is not based on your circumstances that God is love. Friends, even grander, it's not even based on your existence that God is love. That's something that Allah cannot say. That is something that Buddha cannot say. That is something that Confucius cannot say. Because God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rested in love, and therefore He is love. You cannot love something unless there's a recipient of that love. And God saw it fit to create humanity in His image, to share and give that same love. Even goes as far to say that in the Gospels that Jesus says in John chapter 17 in His high priestly prayer, He says, the same love, enduring, perfect, omnipotent, everlasting, and steadfast love that the Father loves the Son since the beginning of the time, that same love He loves you and me. That's a mind blower. How can we comprehend? So His enduring love has lasted even into eternity past. So what does it mean for His steadfast love here in the present? I want to let you know, He loves you. He loves you today. Specifically, He loves you. He knows your background. He knows your place. He knows your obstacles. He knows your temptations. He knows your secret sins. He knows your not-so-secret sins. He knows where you stand in your relationships. And He loves you with an everlasting love. Now, there's always a choice. Just as I said, there cannot be love unless there's a recipient of that love. The world knows that God loves the world, but the world utterly, adamantly rejects that love. And because the Lord respects and loves His creation, He's going to respect and understand their decision to either walk in righteousness or walk in unrighteousness. That's why no man can say, I don't deserve hell. No man can say, I do not deserve hell. Because God has always given the opportunity. Would you share in relationship with me? I've given my all in order that you might have relationship with me. But if you do not, I'm not going to stop you. Because hell is the complete and utter disconnection of any relationship to God for all of eternity. Right now we have a choice. Right now, as you draw, suck in breath, and expel it out by the grace of God, you have the opportunity to respond to the Lord and His present love for you. He loves His children with a loyal love. Now, this is why in the Hebrew, when it says His steadfast love, and then in some translations it says mercy, it's because it's difficult in the English translation to translate the specific Hebrew word of love. Because it goes so much deeper than our ability to speak in English concerning God's steadfast love. It's this Hebrew word, hesed. Hesed. And it runs deeper than any of our translations. And really, it can only be translated as steadfast love, or even more specific, a covenantal love. A love that comes from a decision, an agreement, a lasting covenant, as if it were a bride to a bridegroom. I remember giving my vows to my wife on our wedding day, setting that covenant of love before her as she set that covenant of love before me. And it was this declaration. This is God instituting this. And this is the same that God covenantally loves you with his vow as he creates you in his image to produce in you a purpose that will last all throughout eternity. He's able to say, I will loyally love you. I will love you with a love that you cannot experience outside of yourself. And it will endure forever, no matter what happens. Talking about the Hesed, it's all over the scriptures. But Psalm 33:5, it says that God's Hesed, his steadfast love, it fills the entire earth. You know what that says about us? About our relationship to God? You can't escape it. As far as you breathe in breath, that you walk upon this earth, there is no way for you to escape God's covenantal love before you as you respond to him. Because you can have this ability to say, I've just gone too far. To standing before God, I've gone too far in my life in the destructive manner. I've gone too far in my life in my sinful lifestyle. I've gone too far in my life for God's love to reach me. That's not what Scripture says. Scripture says his love fills the entire earth. And that gives him the ability to take your sin and throw it as far as the east is from the west. Not simply take your sin and put it in another room to be discovered again, but he extinguishes it with his love. God's love for his church is the same. Thus, appropriately, we are able to say what verses 1 through 4 is able to say. We are able to say, okay, because we've experienced God's love, we can declare it as a truth. So let Israel say, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron, all the way to the Levitical priests, as they laid out their sacrifices upon the altar of God, you say, you Levitical priests, you say, the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. And we go centuries forward, 2,000 years, to this present moment for all those who fear the Lord within the body of Christ Jesus. All across the world, we're able to say, yes, the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever. So what about the future? How does his steadfast love endure? How specifically will it endure? Even into the end of the age. Well, his love endures and remains to the fulfillment of his future promises. Scripture proclaims these promises that have been laid out centuries before are fulfilled in the life and events of Jesus Christ. So that means that should give us affirmation that if Christ is the same yesterday, that he is the same in his covenantal love for me today, that he's going to be the same tomorrow. Even until the time that he sees fit to take his throne and place it upon the earth. That's the future. One day, if God sees it fit to either keep us into eternity or take us, as he did with our dear brother Sasha. I mean, what a wonderful testimony, wasn't that, from the missions moment? That he fulfilled what James declared, that a pure and undefiled religion is to care for widows and orphans in their affliction. That by doing that, being faithful unto the very end, as he expelled his last breath, as he walked daily in faith, knowing, I believe in the truth that Scripture proclaims, that the Lord is good and his love for me endures forever and ever, and I believe it, I believe it, I believe it until my last breath. And I stand before the throne room of God and say, I can see that love with my own eyes. I'm able to view tangibly everlasting love. That is what love in the future speaks of. So let's continue. Let's see how this enduring love kind of hashes out in this song of thanksgiving in the midst of sorrow and hardship. Psalm 118, verses 5 through 13 together. It says, out of my distress, the psalmist says, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and he set me free. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. All nations, they surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees, and they went out like a fire among thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. You might be looking at this text and saying, that is me. That has been my year. 2016 has been my year of being pushed and pushed and pushed to the point that I am falling and I do not have the capacity to pick myself up again. Friends, the truth of Scripture declares His love endures to capture you and to lift you up, to bring you back onto your feet. Because this is what we see from the psalmist is this dialogue, this communication of saying, okay, I know where I was. I was in grand distress, and so I pleaded before the Lord, and in wonder and in grace, He actually answered me. He actually answers prayer. He actually answers our pleas, our supplications, our petitions, our intercessions. He answers when we pray. I mean, can we see how these are truths that are the same and are encouraged for us to speak out, not only in times of success, but in times of great lament and hardship? You know, it's pretty easy to say yes and amen when we're walking in ease and comfort. But there's something special. There's something special about being brought to the end of yourself. When knowing all you have is Christ and being able to say, I do believe. I believe what the psalmist says. I do believe that He, the Lord, is on my side. I do believe that He is my helper. I do believe that He will lift me up, and I take refuge in Him more than any other prince, any other human help on this earth. I mean, verses 8 and 9 is this grand kind of interlude as a saying, you know what, if you just weren't exactly sure, the psalmist is saying, I want to make this point expressly clear. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. James Montgomery Boyce does something interesting, which is amazing to me, is he says that there are 31,174 verses in the Bible. 31,174 verses in the Bible. Psalm 118, verse 8 and 9 is number 15,587 and 15,588, which means it is the exact middle of the Scriptures. The exact middle. And it's somewhat of a speculation. It's kind of waxing poetic. But I think it's grand and wonderful that he takes this declaration, this position would have prominence and attention to our hearts. If you kind of got it twisted, friends, walking in this world, thinking you can trust in man, thinking that you can trust in a sinful world that seeks out for its own success and power, trust in the Lord. He has never failed, and He will never fail. Trust in Him. Even if I'm surrounded, even if you are surrounded in despair, even if despair and the world is surrounding you like a swarm of bees. Can you kind of visualize that? Has anyone been caught in a swarm of bees before? Couple of people. Amen. Amen. You know what's interesting about being caught in a swarm of bees? There's no one that's going to help you. Right? You're gonna be running down the way and get just caught. I mean, I enjoy beekeeping. It's one of my favorite hobbies. It just is like this stress relieving thing just to work with these beautiful insects. And my dad is an experienced beekeeper, and so he's helped me along the way, and it's a great thing for our friendship. And so there's an occasion where I said, you know what, the bees know me. We're friends. I'm their shepherd. I don't need to put on this hood. I don't need to put on these gloves. And so my dad's like, all right. And he's videotaping me with his phone. And I popped the lid because they seal the lid with wax. And so I popped the lid, and it's just this beautiful honeycomb, and it's they're all running around. And the moment I pop the lid, it's just, and I'm gone. I am running. And you know, my dad, of course, he's just standing away, just kind of videotaping the whole thing for prosperity or something. And I'm getting stung in the face and in the ears and on the neck. And you know, you kind of start involuntary, just like moving things out of your own strength. And it's almost impossible because they're surrounding you with no one to come to your aid. And I mean, it's just what a picture that the psalmist is presenting. The everlasting love of God comes to the aid of those that have no help. No help. Who can help when I am falling? The Lord, He helped me. Who can help when I'm surrounded by nations? The Lord, He helped me. And so we ask the question again. We ask the question again, why is it necessary for us to worship in trial? Why is it appropriate for us to thank the Lord in difficulty? Friends, it's because it shakes us into the reality of our circumstances. God is present where I am. He is alive. He loves me, and He will accomplish what is best for my life, even in the midst of suffering. Even in the midst of suffering. Notice in verse 6, it says, as the Lord is on my side, I will not fear. Notice that the psalmist says, the Lord is on my side, I will not suffer. Suffering is guaranteed. Fear doesn't have to be. In the midst of suffering, you can remain stable in the reality that God is on your side. And rest in thankfulness that He will always fulfill that which He sent out to do. What's really amazing about this specific song, this psalm, is that it's the last psalm in a special group of Hebrew songs called the Hallel. And it's Psalms 113 through Psalm 118. That is the Hallel Psalms, and they are sung specifically during the supper of Passover, okay? So during the different cups of drinking wine, they would be singing Psalms 113 and ending on Psalm 118. Do you know what this means? Do you notice why this is impactful? It means that during the Last Supper, the last song that Jesus sung amongst His disciples was this psalm. I mean, can you just picture that for a second? He knew what was coming. He knew what was next for Him. And the moment that those kind of musical notes, the voices of song from His dearly beloved disciples stopped, He knew this is time. We've just sung about the steadfast love of the Lord enduring forever. These people are about to see it firsthand. They're going to see my arms stretched out in excruciating blood and crushed thorns. And I'm going to prove the enduring love of God Himself. It's because of the love of God that you know salvation. That you not only know it, you possess it. Not only you possess it, you become it. Because of who Christ is and what He has done for you and for me. And this is why the psalmist can say, in really a prophetic manner, verses 14 through 18, he's able to declare, the Lord is my strength. He's my song. He has become my salvation. Glad songs of salvation are in the tents of the righteous, because the right hand of the Lord, it does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord, it exalts. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. And this is why, verse 17, I shall not die, but I shall live. And I will live to recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has disciplined me severely, but He has not given me over to death. Notice what the psalmist does in a very poetic manner. He talks about abilities, attributes. He talks about strength. He talks about song. He talks about salvation. But he doesn't talk about them as if they were encouragements. He doesn't talk about how they are abilities or characteristics. He talks about them as if they were a person. The Lord is my strength, the ability, my resiliency, my stability to stand in the midst of suffering, in the midst of a swarm of spiritual bees coming against me. My strength is Christ's strength. He's my song. The Hebrew literal translation of saying he's my song, it's saying he's the source of my joy. I mean, have you ever been so joyful you just start breaking out into song? I mean, it's like some kind of Rodger and Hammerstein musical or something like that. But it's so beautiful, it's so wonderful, because the Lord deserves the songs out of my lips, and so he becomes my song. He is the source of my joy, and I'm able to sing these worship songs even in the midst of suffering and hardship, and he is, because he is my salvation. I have seen salvation, and I know that it comes from God alone. He has brought me to life. He has set me upon the rock to declare the good things that he has done. And therefore, my testimony to the world is this. Your testimony, believers, is this. We will not die. We will live. And we will live to be able to recount the deeds of the Lord. He exalts. He lifts up. His right hand does valiantly. He conquers with honor. And this is pretty amazing too, is the psalmist even brings a caveat here in verse 18. He disciplined me. He punished me. The Lord has disciplined me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Friends, do you know that's the definition of repentance? I know that the Lord, his enduring love, it lasts forever. I know also that as his child, he chastises those he loves. So my response to the Lord is, even though, Lord, I'm being disciplined, even though I'm being disciplined, I know it's not over to death. I know it's for your glory. Can you think about that? Even in verse 18, can you think of Jesus singing these words? How completely wrong it is for him to sing these words? Because he doesn't deserve punishment. He's lived a life of perfection on this earth in order to be our redeeming sacrifice. Yet he is able to declare truthfully, the Lord has disciplined me severely, but he is not giving me over to death. He's disciplined me severely, not for my sin, for your sin. For my sin. He has taken our sin, put it on his shoulders, and the Father looks down upon him as he is suffering upon the cross in excruciating physical pain. And God the Father says, I reject you because of your sin when it wasn't his. Christ is able to say, even in the midst of that, as a willing sacrifice, I will not die. I will live as a victor over death and as the redeemer of all who would call upon me. And because of his death and resurrection, we now have access to righteousness. And therefore, we are able to declare, as verse 19 through 24 says, open to me now, because of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, because of his resurrection, open to me now the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you. I thank you that you have answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And this is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. And this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. When we understand our salvation, when we truly appreciate our access to God's righteousness, not our own, every day is a day worthy of rejoicing. Every day. And this is the life breath expelled out of the believer. Verse 21 is a daily acclamation. No matter what my circumstance, I'm going to thank you that you have answered me and that you have become my salvation. Friends, he is our answer. He is our salvation. That through him we would enter into a family, a body of believers that will endure into eternity, because Christ's love endures into eternity. Ephesians chapter 2 talks all about that. talks about how we are being built together right now because of not of us, not of our goodness, not of our ability, but because his steadfast love is tangible here. It's here in the presence of the house of the Lord. And because of that, our response is this as we come to a close, verse 25 to 29. This is our petitioning prayer. Save us. We pray, O Lord. Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And we communally, corporately, as a church, we bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God. He has made his light to shine upon us, and we bind the festal sacrificial sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. That save us is that grand Hosanna word. Bring us, Lord, save us. We cannot save ourselves. Daily would you sanctify us. Daily would we experience your enduring, self-sacrificial, steadfast, covenantal, loyal love in order that I might endure another day of suffering on this earth. We understand this because Christ understood this. Psalm 118 speaks about a deliverer who is welcomed in the open gates as Jesus was welcomed into the gates of Jerusalem. As they proclaimed hosannas before him and blessings, yet he also knew, I am the chief cornerstone who is going to be rejected, not for my sin, but for our sin. Exactly according to the word and spirit of Psalm 118. And this is why the psalmist says, I don't know if knowingly, but possibly through the prophetic nature of the Holy Spirit, I wonder if the psalmist is able to say, we know the horror of the sacrifice that's about to come, but in joy, we bind those cords. We bind that sacrifice to the altar, knowing that it is the only means by which we might have salvation, and we declare before everyone that Christ's greatest suffering endures into our ultimate joy. His light shining on us, his own Son, who lives in us and calls us to be light in order that we might be instruments of his love. I mean, can we witness this? Can we close our eyes? Can we visualize this for a moment? As if you were standing upon Calvary itself. There he is, bloody, and he's beaten. The crown of thorns is crushed upon his head. And we stand back outside of the physical realm and look at the spiritual, and we see the weight of eternity, the weight of sin since the beginning of time upon his shoulders. We hear the voice of God the Father saying, I must reject you because I can have no relationship with sin. And we look upon the face of Jesus, and we would say the words of the psalmist in verse 28 and 29, you are my God. I will give thanks to you. You are my God. I will extol you. I give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Our God is greater than any other God, because no other God stooped to this earth to suffer in a greater way than we could ever suffer, in order that we might have access to faith and an eternity of seeing love for the very first time. That's why we thank him in our trials. That is why we thank him in our hardships, because he does not change. And he is our answer to salvation. If God is for us, then who can be against us? Lord, that's our heart. That's our response to you this morning. Lord, we know from your scripture that says, if you counted transgressions, Lord, who would be able to stand? Lord, we cannot stand alone. We need your enduring love to prop us up, to give us our citizenship into heaven, to give us access to the Father. Lord, you were rejected so that we would be accepted. Lord, you were beaten so that we could be saved. Lord, you endured the cross. You endured the shame. You endured the guilt in order that we might be free from sin. So, Lord, we respond in worship to you this evening. No matter how this year has panned out for us, Lord, what remains is our worship to you. And that is more valuable than temporary experience. Lord, they matter. The hardships are hard. The weight is hard. The obstacles are hard. And we walk daily knowing that, Lord Jesus, you are living within us, that your words are true, and that your love with us, for us, endures and will not fade, does not wax, does not wane, because you are our shepherd to our flock, and we trust in you as a congregation, as individuals, for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.